There's a lot of confusion around coronavirus. On one hand, we have the media, wall-to-wall, 24-hour coverage, feels like the end of the world. On the other hand, we have some voices trying to downplay all of this, saying it's all hysteria or even a hoax. Obviously, this is serious. There's no question about that. All the experts are clear. The World Health Organization, the CDC, leading epidemiologists and virologists. It's true that right now, the odds of infection are low. There's a small percentage of people that are infected. And we want to keep it that way. That's the point. We want to prevent the spread or at least delay it as much as possible. You've seen the meme that's going around, flatten the curve. The more you delay things, the better we can deal with it. The healthcare system, the hospitals, all of society. Hence the recommendations to avoid crowded areas, especially if poorly ventilated, closed spaces with a lot of people. So unnecessary air travel, large events, etc. Several institutions have taken the initiative. Conferences have been canceled. Universities are moving their classes online. I know USC and UCLA, where I worked for years, they did it just this week. And Harvard, MIT, Stanford, Yale, many others have moved all their activity online as well. And I agree with that, of course. It's drastic, it's disruptive, but it will probably be incredibly effective at containing the spread. Because if there's a couple of things we know about this virus, it's number one, it's not like the flu. It's much more lethal.
The mortality of this is multiple times what seasonal flu is.
There are more deaths currently from flu because flu is more widespread, and corona is not, and we want to keep it that way. That's the point. And number two, measures to contain it seem to work. Big silver lining. In China, the epicenter, they were actually able to contain it a lot. Of course, in the beginning when the whole thing started, they tried to put the lid on it and silenced whistleblowers and all that. But when stuff really hit the fan, they did clamp down hard on it, and the containment has been incredible. From 2,000 new cases a day a while back to now less than 100. That's a big drop. Wuhan's a huge place. I was there like 10 years ago. Massive city. 11 million. It's more than twice the population of Los Angeles. Imagine putting that many people on lockdown. It's almost unthinkable, but they did it, and it worked. Now, it required what some journalists are calling draconian measures, and which may not be possible in societies where there's more freedom. That's okay. There's more silver lining, more good news. South Korea, they've done an amazing job. The number of new cases has dropped a lot. And they did it using technology, public education, and healthcare initiatives. They informed their population early on, like weeks ago, to work from home and avoid crowded areas, all that stuff. They set up drive-through testing stations. Look at that. You drive through, you get swabbed, and they send you the results a couple hours later. All 100% free of charge. In the US, we're a little behind the ball. We'll get there eventually. I'm confident we have to. This can be turned around. Here's the head of the World Health Organization. We cannot say this loudly or clearly or often enough. All countries can still change the course of this pandemic. So the voice is downplaying this, saying it's no biggie, it's all hysteria, we got this. Whether it's Elon Musk or some of the Washington people.
We have contained this. We have contained this. I won't say airtight, but pretty close to airtight.
It's usually somebody with no training in virology or epidemiology, which tells us everything we need to know. When in doubt, listen to the CDC, listen to the World Health Organization, listen to Anthony Fauci. Those are the people with the firsthand information and the expertise. Crises always brings out the best and the worst in us. On one hand, we have brilliant minds working together to figure this out, and we'll overcome it. I'm sure of it. On the other hand, there's always somebody trying to use the opportunity to attract attention or profiteer. All kinds of people pushing herbs and supplements that are going to protect you from corona. There's not a shred of evidence that any of these supplements and magic pills are going to help you prevent infection from coronavirus. Being in good general health, that's what always helps against any threat, virus or not. Healthy diet, exercise, sleeping well, not being stressed all the time, that's it right there. Nobody's going to get rich off of that advice, but that's where you're going to get the most bang for your buck. You don't need the shady pill from the online store with zero studies to back it up. Another silver lining. Not only is our risk of getting infected currently pretty low, and we want to keep it that way, hence the precautions, but even in the unlikely event that we do get infected, the risk of getting serious disease and death is relatively low. Much higher than the flu, but still relatively low. Now, it's not the same for everybody. You've heard that children seem to be pretty immune to it. Zero deaths recorded under 10 years old. They can be carriers, but they don't seem to be affected by it much. Really under 50 years old, very low death rate, and then it starts to slowly creep up. 60 and above is when it starts to get significant, especially with comorbid conditions, other diseases, heart disease, cancer, asthma, diabetes, obesity. Again, general health is the key. So that's the main population we're trying to protect with these measures. We're trying to contain the spread so they don't get hit too hard. And the healthcare system in general as a consequence. Now, the mask thing, several sources are consistent. The mask is not necessary. If you have symptoms, wear it to prevent spreading it. If you're going to be around six people, sure. Otherwise, going about your daily normal business, they don't seem to do much. Now, I don't think they hurt either. So if you feel more comfortable wearing a mask, why not? But I don't think we need to be panicking to buy them or to stock them or to steal them from hospitals like we're seeing in certain places. The irony is the thieves probably exposed themselves to more risk by going to the hospital to steal the masks than they prevented by wearing them. Washing your hands really well, disinfecting them, yes. Here's Anthony Fauci explaining it really well.
Washing your hands as frequently as you can. One of the problems with respiratory-borne diseases is that they are spread either by droplets, gross droplets, someone coughs or sneezes on you, or even a bit of aerosolized, where you can be sitting next to someone very closely and you don't cough and sneeze, but the virus can aerosolize. And it will get in through a mucosal surface that could either be your nose, your mouth, or even your eye. The reason for washing your hands is that people often do the wrong thing. That's why you hear us say, cough into the crook of your elbow, because people sometimes go like this or blow their nose. They'll shake hands with you, touch a doorknob. 15 minutes later, you come by and do that. Then you touch your face, and that's how you get it.
So bottom line, my view is, yes to precautions, no to panic. Let's be smart and avoid unnecessary risks and control the controllables so that we can contain this and flatten the curve. The last important message I have is regarding the media coverage. It's disproportionate. This is important, absolutely no question about it, but it's not the only threat we face. It's not even the main one. Even in a worst case scenario where everybody gets infected, hypothetically speaking, the experts estimate ballpark 1 to 3% mortality rate, somewhere in there, 2%, 3%, 4%, okay, for coronavirus, very significant. But heart disease is killing 20 to 30% of the total population right now. No hypotheticals. And we know it's largely preventable. So it's not even in the same league. You're not going to hear this from the media because virus talk gets eyeballs and clicks. So it's going to continue to be 24/7. But the truth is the threat from the usual suspects, heart disease, cancer, etc., is much greater. It doesn't mean we pretend coronavirus doesn't exist. We don't ignore it. We are aware of it. We fight it. We prevent the spread, but as we do it, just be aware that the exclusive focus on this is not proportional to the threat it represents for us. It's proportional to novelty and shock value. To keep things in perspective is to address the virus, to stop the spread, to do everything we can, while at the same time continuing to pay attention to prevention of heart disease, cancer, strokes, the main causes of death 6 months ago when Corona just meant a Mexican beer, the main causes of death right now, and in all likelihood, the main causes of death for a long time to come.
If you thought that video was useful, consider sharing with others who might be interested and hit that like button and subscribe for more nutrition made simple. Also, feel free to link up with me on my Facebook page and on Twitter for more in-depth nutrition science. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you on the next one.